As lawmakers try to reach a deal on the budget and consensus on new voting maps, conservative Christians gather outside the legislature in what can only be described as part revival meeting, part political rally.
USA! USA!
Rally organizer Ron Beatty, pastor of Berean Baptist Church in Winston-Salem, introduces the keynote speaker with news that excites the crowd.
This week, our lieutenant governor stated that there's a 95% chance that he will be running for the governor of the state of North Carolina.
Mark Robinson spoke about God, country, and his controversial comments describing the LGBTQ community as filth. He never mentions running for governor, but his speech sounds very much like a man running for something.
The angry and indignant patriots of the United States and North Carolina are going to rein this government back in control. It's time for us to teach our nation a lesson. And that lesson is this: you are not in control. We are in control. This is government of the people, by the people, for the people.
A Robinson supporter who doesn't want her name used for fear of retribution for backing the lieutenant governor explains why she supports him.
He refuses to bow to the stereotypes. He refuses to embrace the victim stance, to say my limitations or that the color of my skin is a handicap. It is not a handicap.
One candidate who has declared his plans to run for the U.S. Senate next year spoke out in defense of the lieutenant governor.
When Mark Robinson had the courage to stand up and call sin what it is, he was left hanging by too many of our politicians.
Former Congressman Mark Walker didn't stop there, raising questions about election integrity.
We need to get our election process and election integrity where it needs to be as well. We need to make sure every vote counts. And in the words of Senator Tim Scott, we're okay with everybody voting, but we're not okay with the cheating.
Pastor after pastor told this crowd today that the problem is government and that the solution is God. In Raleigh, Bill O'Neill, WXII 12 News.
Across the country, an amped-up redistricting battle is going on right now. So far, six states have already finalized their maps, and like a decade ago, Republicans have the advantage because they control the legislatures in those states. There is a growing call for independent commissions to draw the lines and prevent potential gerrymandering, but some say it's not possible to take the politics out of the process.
Everything is gerrymandered to begin with. To try to start somewhere middle through the process and create, you know, unaligned districts with independent commissioners to me is naive and ultimately won't work.
This is the first time redistricting is happening since the Supreme Court ruled that states with a history of racial discrimination do not need the Justice Department to pre-approve their maps.
And still ahead, we have a gem for our game of the week. We'll fill you in on what's at stake between two undefeated teams tonight.
And tricks, treats, and scares. A Try at Home goes all out for Halloween, even attracting families from out of town. Plus,
when you came home from school, that's kind of something that you would watch, and it was always amazing.
She has been enamored by Bob Ross since she was a little girl, and now she is following in his footsteps, how she's teaching the joy of painting one stroke at a time. Well, a major road in Greensboro just reopened after a police investigation.
WXII 12's Leanne Dinger joins us live on West Wendover Avenue. And Leanne, what have you been able to find out?
Well, if you are out and about in Greensboro, there is a lot of traffic around the city today. But just over my shoulder, police had been working on an investigation. Just over my shoulder here, you can see they are gone now. We do have a little bit of information from Greensboro police. They do say that someone was shot. They were investigating in the 2700 block of West Wendover Avenue. They say that that incident happened just after 3 o'clock. Again, if you are out and about tonight or planning to go out and about in Greensboro, there is quite a bit of traffic, but it does look like within the last few minutes or so, things are starting to make some improvements. As we were driving around from another story, making our way over to this part of the city, we ran into a lot of traffic, different roads being blocked off. They did span quite a distance. Police told us that they blocked off the roads from West Friendly to West Market, so quite a bit of distance there. But traffic moving along nicely now. We do know that one person was shot, and we are going to work to get you some more information. We'll have that to you as soon as possible. In Greensboro, Leanne Denyer, WXII 12 News.
Thank you, Leanne. Last year at this time, we were dealing with severe storms from Tropical Storm Zeta as it made its way up the coast. From snap trees to down power lines to flash floods, it was felt across the Piedmont Triad. Now, Zeta was a late season major hurricane that made landfall in the Yucatan Peninsula and then in southeastern Louisiana. It was the record-tying sixth hurricane of the year to make landfall in the U.S. And turning now to Michelle, I guess hurricane season is almost over. That's one good thing.
It is almost over, right? Yeah, end of November. I'm looking forward to it. You can see here, we've got temperatures out there at 58 degrees. Lots of shower chances tonight, and it does feel like we're just stuck in this pattern. We've had it for the last couple of days, some clouds, some rain, and heavy at times with even thunderstorms. Now we're just talking about those lingering showers. So this is a good thing that we don't have the consistent showers that are kind of winding up with heavier rain. It's going to be light rain, and we look ahead, we're going to have a really nice Halloween, your trick-or-treat forecast, maybe a little bit of shower action in the mountains early on Sunday morning, but look at this, gorgeous by the evening hours. We're looking at 64 degrees across parts of the Triad with 59, turning a little bit on the chilly side as we get you into late evening. So yes, when we say layers, we mean maybe a light jacket or at least long sleeves underneath some of those costumes. We've got you down tomorrow morning to 48 degrees. This is still pretty chilly too. Tomorrow, though, we still have a similar day. You're going to see some sunshine trying to break free in the middle of all those heavy clouds, and then you're going to see a passing shower possibility. So clouds and sunshine, that mild breeze. At times it could be a little bit gusty, but overall a pretty comfortable day. So this is how it's shaping up. You can see from early morning we're at 48, and then we do begin to drop off those clouds the later we go. The winds are out of the west-southwest at about 8 to 12 miles an hour. And tonight for your Friday night football, of course, we've got those shower chances still in play. And even though we're talking about cooler conditions area-wide tomorrow, we have at least some dry patches to look forward to. And that sunshine, it is going to be sensational too. Mountain temperatures right now, they are sitting in the 50s. And tomorrow, you're going to be just a touch cooler. We think low to mid 50s from today, tomorrow low 50s. We think the clouds are going to hang on a little longer, and that upper low takes its time winding up out of here. It's spread out across much of the midsection of the country, so it's going to take a little bit of time out there. We do have better rain chances too coming up as we look ahead. And take a look here. You can see the hour by hour forecast. Shower chances mainly over the mountains tonight and west. And then we do see that drop off in rain throughout the afternoon hour. So better rain chances first initially, and then we start to wind things down. By your Sunday morning, still could see one of those fingers of that low, that trough that's wrapping around overhead in the mountains, but this is going to pull away. And so by middle of the afternoon, you're going to see much more sunshine. And for everybody east, it does look like a very nice, mostly sunny kind of Sunday afternoon and dry. So a lot of leaves might be on the ground, might be doing a little bit of raking, and we've got those, or leaf blowing, right? Oh, hopefully it's not going to be too noisy out there. Do you see that little pop of snow as we get you head into early next week? There's going to be some cooler temperatures, mainly West Virginia and north, fortunately. Take a look at your football forecast. Saturday at Truist Field, homecoming. We've got temperatures out there in the 50s, so it is cooler, but then we should see those temps hopefully hover in the low 60s at times as we wind down the afternoon, and rain chances in the mountains as well. Yeah, continue throughout most of your Saturday into your Sunday. So unfortunately, the App State game may be a little bit rainy out there. Want to remind you too about November 7th. We've got our clock setting back 1 hour. This is time to fall back. So sunrise is at 6:49 and the sun sets now at 5:19. As we're now, of course, seeing those clocks change up things as we had a look ahead. Take a look at the beaches. We're going to be mostly sunny there too. From Nags Head, Emerald Isle, and Myrtle Beach over the next 2 days, we've got sunshine returning there. So the clouds don't seem to get stuck along the beaches as much as they do across the Triad and the foothills, as well as the mountains the next couple of days. Looking good for everybody though. By Monday, we dry out. We see mid and upper 60s. So Saturday is our cooler day of the weekend. But then we rebound to seasonable conditions through Tuesday. Your rain chances then returning later in the week, but only at 20% right now, and certainly a little bit cooler from time to time.
We are in the final week of the regular season for high school football.
Yeah, it went by just like that, and we're capping it off with a battle of undefeateds tonight in our Game of the Week. Sports Director Lauren Walsh is here live in studio with a preview. Lauren, this is a good one on paper.
It sure is. It's not just any game of the week. The Metro 4A Conference saved the best for last. Undefeated Grimsley visits undefeated Northern Guilford. The conference title is on the line. The conference's top playoff seed is also at stake. And these two squads are squaring off in a battle royale in Greensboro. No team has been able to knock off the Whirlies or the Nighthawks. These teams just define dominance. Get this, through 9 games, Grimsley averages a 31-point win margin, and Northern has an average win margin of 37 points. These two Titans are the only undefeated teams to meet tonight in Week 11. We have regular season finales all around the area, and we hope you join us for High School Playbook tonight at 11:15 as we round out the regular season action. Lots of conference championships and playoff spots are on the line. Grimsley and Northern Guilford kick off our game of the week at 7:30. Reporting in studio, I'm Lauren Walsh. Back to you.
All righty, thank you, Lauren. Let's get a check on traffic now. This is Salem Parkway at Macy Grove Road in Kernersville. No issues, as you can plainly see, in either direction here. Well, check your fridges for this hummus. It's being recalled all across the country. We'll explain why.
And a spooky display is raising eyebrows in the Ardmore neighborhood, and we're going to head there coming up.
WXII 12 News is always available on the free WXII 12 app. Stay connected to Kenny Beck on his Facebook page.
It is almost Halloween, and neighborhoods here in Winston-Salem are showing off their Halloween spirit. And in Ardmore, there is one house that neighbors find particularly spooky. The owner and his friends dressing up some of Halloween's scariest characters and life-size decorations has made this house the top trick-or-treat spot in the Ardmore neighborhood for nearly two decades. The house even attracts trick-or-treaters from out of town. Pierce Clarkson, their neighbor, says that he loves the Halloween spirit.
It's absolutely amazing. It's the place to be, not just in Ardmore, but around Winston-Salem and the Triad. People come, they drive from all over the city, all over the area. We had people last year, even during COVID, when it was quieter than normal, people were coming in from Yadkinville. I said, that's great. They said, yeah, we know where to come for Halloween.
The owners of the house say that they'll be ready for trick-or-treaters by 5 o'clock Halloween night, but after dark, the true fun will begin.
That's ominous. Well, if you're looking for some Halloween family fun elsewhere, there are plenty of local events happening throughout the weekend. As you might imagine, the 6th annual downtown Greensboro trick-or-treat event is Saturday on Elm Street from 2 to 5 in the afternoon at participating businesses throughout the downtown area. You can also head to Howl-O-ween with Greensboro Parks and Rec. It's open to kids, adults, and dogs, as the name suggests. That's happening Saturday at Country Park from 1 until 4. And today is also the final day to reserve your spot for Boo at Bethabra. That's happening at Bethabra Park on Saturday afternoon from 1:30 to 4:30. There's going to be a ghost walk and spooky stories. Call the number on your screen if you're interested in registering.
And you can ride in style this weekend for Halloween in three U.S. cities. Customers who request an UberX in Atlanta could find themselves being picked up in Scooby-Doo's Mystery Machine. In Los Angeles, people may see the SpongeBob SquarePants paddy wagon pull up. And riders in Miami could find themselves in the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles party wagon. There's no way to request one of the vehicles. Getting one is just the luck of the draw.
As the president meets with world leaders, I'm Jared Hill in Washington with why some congressional Democrats say holding off on an infrastructure vote could help the president on the global stage.
And we're still chilly out there right now. We've got some scattered showers out there from Wisconsin all the way to the Triad. We're going to have details and talk about what we have in store for your Halloween forecast and that Friday night football is next.
You're watching WXII 12 News.
All this month, cyber experts all across the country are pushing all of us to get a little bit better at protecting our devices and our personal data.
With the threat of hackers, ransomware, and other cyber risks, there are certainly a lot of questions about this.
So, Chief National Investigative Correspondent Mark Albert asked one of the top cyber leaders at the Department of Homeland Security for some best practices.
It is Cybersecurity Awareness Month. So what is the number one message you want our audience to know?
The number one message for every American is that cybersecurity is a risk that can affect every person.
The second in command of the Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency says we all can blunt the threat of being hacked.
If I'm sitting at home, how am I supposed to fight China and Russia? They're smarter than I am on cyber, aren't they?
You know, there are steps that every individual and family can take.
His top step, turn on multi-factor authentication for email, social media, and financial accounts, essentially requiring a second password that's sent to you instantly.
I'm going to turn on the option for text message, which means that I'm going to receive a message to my phone when I log on for an added verification to make sure that it's me and not a cyber intruder. Once I hit send code, I'm going to click here. Then I'm going to get a confirmation code on my phone. I'm going to put it into this screen here, hit next, and I'm done. Simple as that. And by using multi-factor authentication, we have research showing that we can block over 90% of cyber intrusions.
Ann Goldstein suggests using a password manager with unique passwords for every site. In Washington, I'm Chief National Investigative Correspondent Mark Albert.
Microsoft said this month one in five accounts targeted are those of consumers, the rest businesses, and that the U.S. is the most targeted country by far on the planet.
At least 89% of vaccinated American adults will qualify for COVID-19 booster shots. This includes everyone who received a Johnson & Johnson shot. All of those people qualify for a booster shot 2 months after their original dose. Those who got the Moderna or Pfizer vaccine can get a booster shot at least 6 months after their second shot.
Well, here's a new one. A new study shows COVID-19 can infect the inner ear. Researchers at MIT and Massachusetts Eye and Ear studied 10 COVID patients. They found the virus can actually infect the inner ear, specifically hair cells, which are critical for both hearing and balance. The new findings add to previous indications from many COVID patients who reported symptoms affecting the ears, including hearing loss. The European Medicines Agency says there is insufficient evidence to prove a link between COVID vaccines and multi-system inflammatory syndrome. MIS is rare and impacts several parts of the body at the same time. The committee says, based on research that it has, an update on the product information was not warranted. However, it encouraged physicians to continue to report any cases of MIS in patients that have been vaccinated against COVID.
President Biden started his big international trip today, meeting with political and religious leaders on topics like global security and climate change. But domestic issues are still a big part of the political conversation. Jared Hill is in Washington with details.
Kenny and Kim, the White House is saying that these twin tent poles of President Biden's agenda could touch almost every American. And because they're still in flux, there continues to be a tension on infrastructure, even as international relations are taking center stage.
In Italy, diplomacy on display. President Biden trying to smooth things over after a U.S. deal with Australia undercut our French allies.
I was under the impression that France had been informed long before that the deal was not coming through.
The multi-day European trip kicked off with a meeting with the Pope before the G20 in Rome and climate talks in Scotland. All of it as President Biden's agenda is on the line at home.
He heads there now with some uncertainty about how much he can deliver in terms of climate change and in terms of, you know, domestic stability.
Congressional Democrats are putting the finishing touches on one bill to try and clear the path for another.
We are looking at that text. We will go through it.
Analyzing the $1.75 trillion Build Back Better package after punting a Thursday vote on infrastructure, progressives are pushing for both to go together.
We simply did not have the votes for the bipartisan bill without the other bill, the Build Back Better Act, which has 85% of the president's agenda.
With Republicans refusing to be on board, Dems need to lock in every vote. While they say they're close to a deal, there's still distance between progressives and centrists.
Not a big Democratic division, but on a teeny little division. But when things are as close as they are, that brings the whole process to a stop.
Lawmakers have not set a new deadline for when they'll vote on the infrastructure packages. Reporting in Washington, I'm Jared Hill for WXII 12 News.
Thank you, Jared. A look at traffic. This is a live look at I-40 at McConnell Road in Greensboro, and things look good in all directions now. Well, you might want to rethink your dinner plans if hummus is in it. Why this brand is recalling hundreds of one of their products.
Plus, a local woman is picking up a paintbrush and spreading joy, and she gave me a few lessons, too. We'll meet this local Bob Ross instructor when we return.
But first, here's a look at how the stocks finished the day on Wall Street, and they hit another record high. A popular brand of hummus sold in North Carolina and 22 other states is being recalled. Cedars Mediterranean Food says that a batch of its Cedars Organic Mediterranean Hummus may contain pine nuts, and they're not listed on the label. The product was sold in 10-ounce containers and has a sell-by date of December 12, 2021. People who have allergies to tree nuts run the risk of serious or even life-threatening allergic reactions. So far, though, no one has gotten sick.
The CEO of Patagonia is hoping that other companies will boycott advertising on Facebook. Patagonia first pulled its ads from the site last year because it claimed Facebook was spreading hate speech. Now it's asking other companies to follow suit. CEO Ryan Gellert says he wants sponsors to put pressure on Facebook to change its ways. Facebook is facing quite a bit of scrutiny right now for multiple reasons, including how user data is shared and how hate speech is or is not censored. A cast member of The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills was robbed while her children were home. LA police say three men broke into Dorit Kemsley's house last night. The break-in came just one day after a Real Housewives episode aired where Kemsley bragged about her designer clothing. So far, no one has been arrested.
Well, they just got married and an unexpected celebrity surprised them on their big day. Can you guess who it is? Let's just say life is like a box of chocolates. That probably gave it away.
Tom Cruise. Harrison Ford.
Oh, boy. Who could it be? Well, we're talking about lots of sunshine out there mixed with some clouds and then some more, yes, rain chances. We have even a chance tonight if you're heading out for Friday Night Football. Take a look at Graham, though. We've had some clearing there. Talk rain chances next.
We have a great 12 Inspires for you tonight. A few years ago, I met a local artist with a very specific specialty, painting like Bob Ross. I wanted to do a story with her ever since. COVID put things on hold, unfortunately, but recently we finally got to link up and it was worth the wait.
Such a wonderful day here, and I hope it is wherever you're at. I'm gonna have a happy little tree. He lives right there, just a little guy. It's our world. We can do anything that we want here. Even trees need a friend. We all have to have a friend, so we just put one right there.
403 episodes, dozens of happy little mountains, and one unforgettable hairdo. Thanks to YouTube and Netflix, Bob Ross and his Joy of Painting series are as popular as ever, more than a quarter century after the last episode aired. Julie Belknap of Winston-Salem remembers watching the show as a little girl.
When you came home from school, that's kind of something that you would watch, and it was always amazing. 30 minutes, painting done, and then it was a masterpiece.
A UNCG graduate with an art degree, she recently decided to take her love of painting and of Bob to the next level. In 2018, she completed a rigorous course in Florida to become a certified Bob Ross instructor.
It's a 3-week long process, and each week that you go, it gets a little bit more difficult. We ended up knocking out 2 paintings a day the third week. And then a lot of it's on your own. Here's your painting, take off.
So, can she make a painter out of me? Full disclosure, I'm a big Bob fan too, and have tried to paint like him before on my own with varying success. Having Julie walk me through the whole process step by step made a real difference.
I'm going to put mine right here and go up a little bit and then come down.
Yes, let's do some trees. This is my bravery test, right?
That's exactly
right. All right.
We're going to do a little fall color down there too.
We're going to give him a friend? Everybody needs a friend, right?
At least one friend.
Okay. After a little more than an hour, we had our finished products.
Kenny's looks good. Look at that.
Yeah, it came out okay. This was a lot of fun. Thank you very, very much.
We had a blast. And at a time when life is so heavy for so many people, doctors say having some kind of creative outlet or soothing escape is critical for your mental health.
When we think about preventing depressive episodes, we want people to have pleasant events that are regularly incorporated into their day-to-day, as well as mastery experiences where you get to learn a new skill or create a product at the end. And a creative expression checks both of those boxes. The real measure, I would say, is how it makes you feel. If that is soothing and relaxing and feels good, then that is likely to have a benefit.
Until next time, I'd like to wish each and every one of you happy painting, God bless, and we'll see you soon.
And if you'd like to reach out to Julie Belknap, we'll have her email address in this story on our website, WXII12.com, in just a few minutes.
I gotta admit, that was better than I thought it would be. That's really good.
Thank you.
I don't mean that.
No.
I've only done it
a few times prior to that, but having her say, okay, you're going to use this here,
right,
and being able to see how she did it. And then, you know, you try to follow along on Bob on YouTube, and
right,
it's like, slow down, yeah, you know. And the fact that he could do it in like 22 minutes and it was done and it looked so gorgeous.
Amazing.
Such a talent. And sadly, he left us many, many, right, many years ago. Mm-hmm. But as popular as ever, thanks to Netflix and YouTube.
And has always been popular with you. So fun fact about Kenny, what do you do before you go to bed every night?
I fall asleep watching a Joy of Painting episode. Yeah.
That's a great way to do it.
I love it. I think that's a nice idea, don't you?
I do.
I can't wait.
It's very relaxing.
I'm excited. I want to try this out. My son loves to paint, and he's a great painter. So we go and do some of those paint your own sessions together. And that's
do it outside.
Yeah.
Not in the house.
Yeah.
Outside with stuff that can, you know,
special,
easily buff out.
I've got special rugs that absorb a lot of the paint.
Okay.
I have two boys, so mess, it comes with the territory. We've got temperatures at 64 degrees, and you know, indoors is probably where you're going to want to be as you head into early morning Saturday. And then we talk about those shower chances really developing throughout the day off and on. It's going to be very similar to today. We had early morning showers and storms. At least the storms look to be out of the picture tomorrow, but wind's still out of the southwest at about 8 miles an hour. Look at this huge low that continues to spin and just bring in some of those showers for us. Now, a lot of this is just surface moisture, so we're beginning to see some drying aloft. But notice from the Triad all the way back up into parts of Wisconsin and Minnesota, we are seeing some chilly temperatures, but similar, not too far off. We're at 61 in the Triad, about 55 degrees in Milwaukee. And I want to say a big shout out to some young fans who have recently moved, relocated with their family during the pandemic from Winston-Salem. We want to give a shout out to Tiffany and Brad. So hello to you up in Milwaukee and Wisconsin area. Not quite sure where you are, but we do know that temperatures there about the same, actually, from where we are today through tomorrow. So mid to upper 50s there, and we're going to be like a little closer to low 60s in the Triad. Not bad, right? Well, hello to Tiffany and Brad, and thanks for joining us remotely from Wisconsin often. We are glad you're still watching us. All right, 52 degrees in Galax, 61 in Mount Airy, and we've got temperatures at 66 in Burlington. With those spotty showers tonight, it doesn't look like you're going to be drenched in the stands for Friday night football, but you do have some more showers, unfortunately, looking at it. As I said, drenched, I look at those heavier showers and pockets from Shelby lifting out through Statesville. So a few folks out from Wilkes County area, like Wilkesboro right now, maybe a little bit wetter than others. So the rain ponchos would come in handy tonight. Notice where we're getting that drying, though. This is good news. Mid and upper levels are starting to see that pattern. We still need that low to just scoot out of here to dry you out. That happens as we go into Sunday morning. So for now, our hour-by-hour forecast does show those scattered showers lifting through off and on through through 10, 11 o'clock tonight, and then possibly some thinning of the clouds. I wouldn't say clear skies, and if they are clear, they won't be for long. We notice that by the afternoon, we've got some passing showers off and on through the area, and low 60s to upper 50s out there for the Triad and Foothills. And in the mountains, I'm optimistic we might make it into the low 50s, but if you're socked in with the clouds and fog for a little longer, you could stay pretty chilly tomorrow. So it's not a happy day in terms of being in the mountains or along the Blue Ridge Parkway. I think you're going to be a little chillier there. Layers, though, come in super handy, and the rain jackets, the windbreakers. You've got temperatures on Sunday returning into those 60s, in fact, mid-60s. It's going to be a drier Halloween for us. Take a look at the mountains, though, tomorrow. Passing rain, you might even see some drizzle hang in there, along with some of the fog in those mountain valley areas. We've got better chances of that moisture just hugging the mountains. We've got temperatures at 51 degrees, cloudy skies, possibly a passing shower from time to time, and gradually clearing out. Foothills, you've got some sunshine, too, but gusty at times with 60 degrees, and quick passing showers are a possibility. Winds also may be breezy out of the west and southwest for the Piedmont. Winston-Salem, Greensboro, High Point, mild breeze out there with 61. And I think that we're going to have fewer rain chances the later we go through the afternoon. Still wait until Sunday to see that full sunshine. Even in the mountains on Sunday morning, some rain chances overnight into early morning. Then we dry out for Monday as well as Tuesday. But by Halloween, for trick-or-treating everywhere, we are pretty dry and comfortable in those 50s, so very seasonable out there. Halloween highs for everyone, yeah, 60s to 50s, and the 7-day forecast shows a nice streak of sunshine Sunday and Monday, and a few clouds returning for Tuesday with a slight chance of showers later in the week.
I'm Sally Kidd in Winchester, Virginia. This invasive pest, the spotted lanternfly, is causing millions of dollars in damage and spreading rapidly across the U.S. What you need to know coming up.
And still ahead today on WXII 12 News at 6, a shooting has shut down a busy road in the city of Greensboro. We'll have a live report, including where things stand so far and what police are saying. Plus, a scare at a local elementary school after another student is found with a gun. We'll look at some of the circumstances surrounding this and why the school says students were never actually in any danger. Plus, when the city of Winston-Salem could lift its mask mandate. That's coming up at the top of the hour today on WXII 12 News at 6. We hope to see you there.
This edition of the Wake Forest Deacon Minute is brought to you by the North Carolina Education Lottery. Over $8.5 billion raised for education.
You know, it was a hard-fought game. You know, on offense, wow. That was about as clean as a performance as I've ever seen. And every time we had to make a play, we made a play. 70 points, no turnovers, 638 yards. And we needed every single one of them. You know, again, defensively, we didn't play well. You know, we got cut. We got down some bodies. We got some guys hurt. And we didn't play well.
This edition of the Wake Forest Deacon Minute is brought to you by the North Carolina Education Lottery. Over $8.5 billion raised for education.
And good luck to the Deacs this weekend. Traffic around the football field could be a little nutty tomorrow. Here's what things look like right now. This is Highway 52, 3rd Street in the city of Winston-Salem. No delays northbound or southbound. Wade couple even happier on their wedding day. The brides were celebrating their big day on a beach by the Santa Monica Pier in California when suddenly a familiar face appeared in the crowd.
Like, who is this guy walking in our photos? And the crowd is like, that's Tom Hanks. And I'm like, what?
No way.
Right. And he took off his hat and started talking, and immediately we knew it was Tom Hanks. Tom Hanks has such an amazing personality, accepted us for who we are, showed us love like we were family, stuck around and took pictures with our guest. It was great.
Turns out Hanks is something of a wedding crashing professional. Back in 2016, as you might recall, he popped into a couple's photo session and posed with those newlyweds as well.
Hey, he was just out for a walk. Well, Halloween came to the U.S. Senate early on Thursday. Utah Senator Mitt Romney and Kyrsten Sinema reenacted the famous Biscuits with the Boss scene from the first season of Ted Lasso. Romney, as you can see, donned the chino, sweater, whistle, and the mustache sported by Jason Sudeikis in the Emmy-winning Apple TV series. He played Romney during his time on Saturday Night Live, by the way. Romney tweeted at the actor, after 10 years, I'm finally returning the favor. Merriam-Webster has added 455 new words and phrases to its dictionary this month. They include breakthrough, as in breakthrough cases or infections, super spreader, as in super spreader events, long COVID, and vaccine passport. For online culture and communication, there is TBH, for to be honest, FTW, meaning for the win. Other newcomers include dad bod, air fryer, and doorbell camera. So lots of new stuff that we've been using all along.
Sure.
Yep.
Well, speaking of dad bods, apple growers and vineyards have been on high alert in 11 states for an invasive pest, the spotted lantern fly, which sounds quite ominous.
It does. The bug is spreading rapidly, and apple trees and grapes are among its favorite targets. Sally Kidd has the story from Virginia.
On this Civil War battlefield in 1864, General George Custer led one of the largest cavalry charges in American history and broke the Confederate line. Today, the Fort Collier site is battling a much smaller enemy.
This looks like a female right here.
The spotted lanternfly.
This is pretty much a typical spotted lanternfly infestation.
The invasive pest from Southeast Asia has been rapidly munching its way through landscapes since discovered 7 years ago in Pennsylvania.
We now have established infestations in more than 11 states.
The bug has caused tens of millions of dollars in damage.
They excrete a sugary solution known as honeydew. It collects on the surface of the plant, and it forms a substrate for the growth of a non-pathogenic fungus called sooty mold.
Among its favorite targets, fruit trees and vineyards.
They'll kill your vine.
The level of concern is high at Breed A Family Vineyards.
Right now, on average, I see about 20 of these a day.
So Paul Breed A is in battle mode, taking them out as soon as he spots one.
This is our livelihood.
His area of Virginia so infested, it's under quarantine.
We've seen it spread from nearly a square mile of infestation to
well over 200 square miles.
Back at the Civil War battlefield, researchers have set up a test field for spotted lanternfly research.
The USDA has imported parasitic wasps from Asia that could eventually be deployed to attack this invasive species.
Until then, experts advise using insect spray or...
The easiest way to approach them is actually from the front.
Capture and kill.
Smash, brush them off, and stomp on them.
To take this enemy out. In Winchester, Virginia, I'm Sally Kidd.
WXII 12 News at 6 starts right now.
It is Halloween weekend, so we want to get right to the forecast as you get your costumes ready for your children. Michelle Kennedy is in for us tonight. Michelle, we are hoping for no tricks, just treats from your department here in the newsroom.
Oh, we have a few tricks up our sleeve.
I'm sure you do. Wouldn't be a Friday without them.
That's right. We do not really recommend going outdoors during all of that rain that we've seen earlier today, but we do have a rain chance as we get you into tomorrow. But take a look at your Halloween forecast. I think you've got some sunshine on the way, especially by later in the day for folks in the mountains. The mountains is the holdout for those rain chances, and I think that's going to be our problem spot. But take a look at your temperatures at 66 degrees in the Trine to 65 in the foothills. I really like that these temperatures are seasonable. So that means with those clear skies and really lighter winds by then, we're going to have a nice trick-or-treat forecast for you with these dry skies. So dry being the key word. I think it's always miserable when you have to watch out for not only kids maybe running across the streets, but also if you're on your way back home, you don't want to worry about, you know, the rain in addition. So we're going to be dealing with dry conditions. Kids will have a chance to layer up a little bit under the costumes as we cool off into the 50s. And the sunset, of course, around 6:25. So turning a little bit cooler at this point. We've got chilly conditions around 8 o'clock and 56 degrees, mostly clear skies out there. So that's the good news. And we're going to be taking a closer look here over the next few days of seeing that sunshine break free. And we have a nice trend all the way into Tuesday. We'll break down your 7-day forecast a little bit more, but looking good once we get you through tonight and the next 24 hours. It's coming up.
Michelle, thank you very much. A busy road in Greensboro is now back open tonight after a shooting a short time ago. Greensboro police were called to West Wendover Avenue near East Market Street just a few hours ago. Officers say there was at least one person shot. They shut down that road for more than an hour to look into it. We're working to get an update on the victim's condition, and as soon as we do, we will bring that to you on television and online at WXII12.com. COVID-19 vaccinations for younger children are now one step closer to approval. Today, the FDA authorized the kids' side doses of the Pfizer vaccine for people ages 5 to 11. These are one-third of the amount given to teenagers and to adults. The next step is for advisors with the CDC to talk about which groups of children should get vaccinated. All of them, only certain ones, that's to be determined. And that's expected to happen next week. The final step in this process would be the approval of the CDC director, Dr. Michelle Walensky. Once she signs off, children can get the shot. Winston-Salem's Mayor Alan Joyne says he's been getting a lot of questions recently about when the city's mask mandate might be lifted. So he worked with local health leaders to come up with criteria for lifting it. Those conditions include a positive infection rate of 5% or lower for at least 2 weeks based on a 14-day average and less than 10 new cases per 100,000 people per day for an average of 5 days. We are not quite there yet, according to local metrics, but we are close. Infectious disease expert Dr. Christopher Ohl projects we might be able to lift the criteria for the mask mandate by late November. Here's what those metrics stand and look like right now, according to Wake Forest Atrium Baptist Health. Winston-Salem's positive infection rate is 5.3% over the last 2 weeks. So 0.3 percentage points over where it needs to be, and there was an average of 18 cases per 100,000 over the last 5 days, so that's about double what it should be according to lift that mandate. Novant Health says the demand for COVID-19 testing is down, so it's making changes to its testing locations. The Salisbury testing site is now officially closed, and they're also reducing hours of operations at testing locations at Haines Mall in Winston-Salem and another one in East Mecklenburg County. These changes kick in on the 1st of November, which is Monday. Statewide, our daily percentage of positive tests has been slowly dropping over the last month or so. It sits at 4.4% today, and that's within the state's guidelines, below the state's goal of 5% or lower. State Health Department reported 2,366 new COVID cases in the last 24 hours. This is the third day in a row that the case count has been above 2,000 after 2 days, just over 1,000 cases. The number of people fighting the virus in the hospital continues to go down each day. We are now sitting at 1,335 people. Sadly, we did pass the 18,000 mark for total COVID deaths since the start of the pandemic back in March of 2020. Another gun scare tonight at a Winston-Salem Forsyth County school. Here's what we know about this one. It happened this afternoon at Mineral Springs Elementary in Winston-Salem. School leaders say a student brought an older model handgun to school today. It was not loaded and it doesn't even work. It was found after someone told a teacher that a student might have a weapon. The Winston-Salem Police Department confiscated that weapon. The school district says the student will be disciplined. Eden police say a fight between a couple of teenage girls led to shots being fired in the city, and now police say two other people who got involved are also facing charges. Destiny Cardwell is charged with assault with a deadly weapon. Carrie Myers is charged with one felony count of discharging a firearm into an occupied vehicle. Officers were called to three different locations to look into reports of gunshots last night. Police say two groups of people had agreed to meet to carry out acts of revenge. When one car full of people did not stop at a meeting location, another car followed them. Police say that's when the shots were fired. One person was injured. Police say that person was hit by fragments of another object that was struck by bullets. A few thousand people rallied in our state capitol today, protesting everything from critical race theory to COVID mandates. North Carolina's Lieutenant Governor Mark Robinson served as the keynote speaker. Bill O'Neill has the story tonight from Raleigh.
As lawmakers try to reach a deal on the budget and consensus on new voting maps, conservative Christians gather outside the legislature in what can only be described as part revival meeting, part political rally.
USA! USA! USA!
Ministers from across the state, including Forsyth County Pastor Ron Beatty, who organized the rally, call for a return to Christian values and the need for more God, less government.
But we've come here today to stand up for some fundamental facts. And first of all, we stand up for the First Amendment.
Ministers criticize what they call leftist ideas, such as critical race theory.
It has infiltrated our school systems, K through 12, and it's a cancer that has destroyed our universities.
The message struck a chord with parents not happy with public education.
I pulled my daughter from public school because it's unacceptable for me for her going through propaganda such as critical race theory.
Today's biggest cheers came not for a pastor, but for a political leader, Lieutenant Governor Mark Robinson.
Let me say that again real loud for the naysayers. I'm going to thank my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
The Greensboro native who came under fire in recent weeks for his comments describing the LGBTQ community as filth didn't back down, instead lashing out at the media for its coverage of the story.
Because they want you to look and see, well, you know, we shut the lieutenant governor up, made him back up and apologize.
Robinson repeated claims that his comment about filth referred to pornographic books in school libraries and not about people. In what sounded like a campaign speech, the lieutenant governor bashed President Biden, praised former President Trump, and called on the crowd to join him in fighting the left.
Stand with courage, stand with conviction, and tell our enemies on the other side of the aisle that would drag this nation down into a socialist hellhole.
I love all of it because I love America. I want it to get back to what it should be.
And what should it be?
It should be a free country for all. For all.
Pastor after pastor told this crowd today that the problem is government and that the solution is God. In Raleigh, Bill O'Neill, WXII 12 News.
Guilford County Animal Services is celebrating its new location. A brand new $15 million Guilford County Animal Resource Center is on Guilford County Road. The new space was designed with an emphasis on making the experience for four-legged friends and people alike as home-like as possible and as positive as possible. It has larger kennels and connecting doors in the kitty kennels. Well, the greatest homecoming on earth is going on right now in Greensboro at North Carolina A&T State University. Festivities are scheduled throughout this weekend, but the impact of homecoming extends far beyond just campus. Greensboro's Mayor Nancy Vaughn is on A&T's Board of Visitors. She says homecoming is good for campus and good for her city's economy.
It is great to fill up the hotels and the restaurants. It'll be hard to get a restaurant reservation this weekend. North Carolina A&T GHO, greatest homecoming on earth, really is. And so many people take part, and it really is a family event. You know, the alums come back from all over with their kids. It is just a great spirit.
Tonight's festivities feature a step show at 7 o'clock at the Greensboro Coliseum Complex. You will need tickets to get into that event. Well, a front yard turned haunted graveyard. The Halloween display in the Piedmont Triad that goes beyond plastic decorations to give trick-or-treaters a true scare.
And still ahead in sports, we're taking a closer look at our Game of the Week matchup. Plus, Wake Forest has a big one on hand, homecoming Saturday. Panthers injury updates as well.
Ahead for us, the woman in charge.